So 2 weeks ago, we talked about the top 10 reasons for colonizing the Moon before Mars. And last week, we talked about the scenario the other way around. So the top 10 reasons why we should first colonize Mars.
But now we finally want to talk about our preferred scenario. Why decide in the first place? Why not do both at the same time? Could we actually do it? And with we of course mean SpaceX. Could SpaceX really achieve the incredible feat of colonizing both the Moon and Mars at the same time? Well, I'd say, let's find out.
So the old debate, as always, should we first colonize the Moon or first colonize Mars? We extensively talked about the pros for the Moon and the pros for Mars in the last two videos. Video links in the description as always. The debate why we would have to choose one in the first place is of course because no one thought that it might be possible to do both at the same time. The Apollo program, which is the only time when people went to the Moon, cost around 158 billion 2020 inflation-adjusted dollars. NASA's current Moon program, the Artemis program, is projected to cost less, but still probably around $100 billion by the time the first Artemis Moon base is built, at some point in the second half of the 2020s, according to current plans. But a human mission to Mars would of course cost a lot more. Certainly hundreds of billions of dollars. So naturally, everyone thought that this just cannot be done at the same time. Impossible. How could NASA, whose budget has been in decline since the late 60s, ever get the necessary budget for both Mars and the Moon from Congress? As we can see, even the return to the Moon alone, without Mars, proved to be quite difficult and always failed. Every time a new administration tried to put forth a new Moon initiative, because the costs were just too high. Of course, one could argue, strangely, there has always been enough money to build giant amounts of killing machines, right? Well, yes, if you put the same amount of money which the military receives into NASA, we would have giant cities on the Moon and on Mars. Since decades already.
Unfortunately, however, we live in this funny world where the human creature, dictated by its ancient reptilian brain to be as egoistic as possible in order to gain an advantage over the competition in the eternal fight for limited resources, is more inclined to spend huge amounts of money on fighting people from other tribes or nations in this case than spending the money on space exploration. So unfortunately, we cannot change our brains. We still run on software that is 20 or 30,000 years old from the Stone Age, and we would be in dire need of an update. So Elon, hurry up with Neuralink, okay? So therefore, the only realistic solution is to massively, drastically reduce the costs of spaceflight. Enter SpaceX. SpaceX's mission is to massively reduce costs for spaceflight by so much that we won't have to decide anymore between the Moon and Mars. We think that thanks to Starship, we are going to be able to colonize the Moon and Mars at the same time. But can it even be done economically? Let's look at some numbers. We know that Starship will be fully reusable, and after landing, it will be able to launch again very soon thereafter. According to Elon, the fuel for Starship costs around $900,000. He also said that they want to build 1,000 Starships, with the end goal of Starship pricing to be no more than $2 million per Starship. But this is only for the later units. The first tens or hundreds will certainly cost more, and Elon estimated that the number will be around $20 million per Starship for the first 100 units.
Therefore, we have $2 billion for the first 100 starships and $1.8 billion for the following 900. We of course don't know when exactly Starship will be ready and when it can fly the first Moon or Mars missions. But let's just say that the costs will be higher than initially planned, with around $5 billion for the first batch of 100 starships. SpaceX's revenue in 2018 was $2 billion, and in 2019, $2.7 billion. That is already pretty good, but still not good enough to enable Starship development on the long term. Now sure, NASA has awarded SpaceX $150 million to develop a moon version of Starship for their Artemis program, and up to $3 billion will be awarded to a company for the Artemis lunar lander. But we think that NASA won't decide in favor of SpaceX in the end, because knowing NASA, Starship is just too radical for their taste, and they will just stick to an old-fashioned lunar lander design. But the magic will happen with Starlink. If you look at the current rate with which the Starlink satellites are being launched, we can say with great confidence that by early 2021, Starlink will go online for North American customers. The Starlink beta test will already be launched in October this year. So Starlink will already generate some decent earnings for SpaceX in 2021, but it will really start to take off in 2022 and 2023, when thousands of Starlink satellites are in orbit, enabling the network to go online worldwide.
Then many customers from all around the world will want to have this high-speed broadband internet. The military even has already signed an agreement for Starlink use, and we think that Wall Street will certainly also want to have an advantage, because for those super-fast trading bots, every millisecond faster is worth it. And we should not forget that the latency of Starlink is with 20 milliseconds compared to 40 milliseconds of regular sea cables, only half as high. Therefore, massive amounts of revenue will start flooding in, with estimates going as high as $40 billion of revenue by 2025 from Starlink alone for SpaceX. That is an almost 20 times increase from today. This certainly sounds unrealistic now, but this is normal exponential growth. And if we look at Elon's other companies, then we can see how much can actually happen in 5 years. Tesla has really shown what's possible. And already as early as 2021, the first few hundred million dollars from Starlink profit will go fully into Starship development. By 2022, probably more than 1 billion already. Now we know that by that year, in 2022, Elon wants to perform the first cargo flights to Mars. And he recently re-emphasized that SpaceX will stick to that year, and also that SpaceX is now going full in on Starship development. In the same year, we assume that SpaceX will carry out an unmanned landing of Starship on the moon in order to test and validate the Starship systems. We know that in 2023, the Dear Moon mission is planned, where Japanese billionaire Yusaku Mitsawa is going to circle the moon like back in the day with Apollo 8, together with a few artists. By 2024, we think that SpaceX will attempt the first crewed landing on the moon, as a test for Mars.
Will it be a NASA mission? We highly doubt it. Of course, we could be surprised. But as we said, we think that NASA will choose either the Lobby moon lander or Dynetics moon lander for the Artemis moon landings, because this classical lunar lander architecture is more established than the radical Starship design, which is essentially unproven yet. Getting a human rating for Starship by 2024 is, in our opinion, if you look at NASA's bureaucracy overkill, almost impossible. Therefore, it's more likely that SpaceX will conduct a private crewed moon landing mission, either with some of their own people or with some very adventurous and rich private individuals. This will serve as a big test for Starship for future Mars launches. But of course, we shouldn't forget that landing on Mars is very different than landing on the moon, because the Martian atmosphere, of course, requires aerobraking. It's a quite delicate maneuver. And a lot, of course, depends on whether the 2022 cargo Starship missions will successfully land on Mars or not. Should the cargo Starships land on Mars without incidents, and on top, the 2024 moon landing also goes flawlessly, SpaceX might indeed be able to send the first people to Mars in the 2024 launch window.
Now, should either one of those two events encounter some serious issues, we can be quite sure that the first attempt to land people on Mars will be postponed to the 2027 launch window. It will be early 2027, by the way, because Mars and Earth align not exactly every 24 months, so every 2 years, but every 26 months. Elon recently said that the moon starships have no heat shield because they will just remain on the moon. That's what we were suggesting all the time. Even in our older videos, we suggested to land starships on the moon and use them as moon bases. They are really huge and offer 1,000 cubic meter interior volume. If the tanks are additionally utilized, actually quite a lot more, up to 2,400 cubic meters of total interior volume per starship. Most of the starships will just be left on the moon, with a few probably returning to moon orbit in order to dock with the lunar gateway and bring the astronauts back to Earth from the gateway, possibly with an Orion capsule. But even cooler would be if a Dragon capsule would actually dock to the moon starship in orbit and bring the astronauts back to Earth. So while the moon base will be growing and more starships will join in, the Mars launch window will approach, and either in late 2024 or in early 2027, a massive fleet of starships with the first colonists on board will launch for Mars. And by that time, the necessary funding will be absolutely no problem anymore. Because as we said, by the mid-2020s, Starlink will generate probably around 2 times NASA's annual budget every single year, which will fully flow into starships for the Moon and Mars colonies. And since we said that 1,000 starships only cost around $4 billion, with refueling and the whole additional infrastructure needed, let's say pessimistically $10 billion, there will be a lot of additional budget left for building the actual colonies themselves. We can't even imagine SpaceX acquiring expandable habitat technology from the leftovers of Bigelow Aerospace. We see SpaceX utilizing Tesla battery storage systems and solar panels both for the Moon and Mars. Although on Mars, a lot more solar panels would be needed than on the Moon, since the solar flux on Mars is on average only half that of the Moon, with 590 watts per square meters on Mars compared to 1390 watts per square meters on the Moon. But we think that SpaceX might have some difficulties in utilizing nuclear thermal electric generators, because currently only NASA has space-grade nuclear generators, and as we said, if Starship is not NASA human-rated, then NASA will most likely not participate in these missions and therefore also not provide their space-grade nuclear generators.
And the rest will be history. The Moon and Mars colonies will grow and grow. And if we are to believe Elon, by 2050, 1 million people will be living on Mars. Even only 100,000 people by 2070 would already be absolutely amazing. But Elon has always been able to surprise us. By then, we will have even more people living on the moon in giant cities. Lunar crater domes, for example a Shackleton dome, would be a great idea. These domes could even contain outer rotating ring segments, in order to create higher artificial gravity by means of the centrifugal effect. And then, what then? After having established 2 other worlds for humanity to live on, what comes next? Well, many things come next. For example, probes to other star systems, discovery of alien life, colonizing of other solar system bodies, such as Enceladus, Titan, Callisto, Triton, Miranda, Mercury, Venus, and many more. But as for Mars, we believe that by the end of the 21st century, or at the beginning of the 22nd, terraforming efforts will start being undertaken in earnest. And how exactly Mars terraforming can be done, and if it is even doable, we will analyze it in our next week's video.
So if you want to know the top 10 reasons why it makes more sense to colonize either the Moon or Mars first, you can watch the videos right here.
So thanks for watching the JI's Space Report on Friday. And I would say, on to the future. You can just see if you want to know the top 10 pros for first Moon or Mars, look here.
Perfect.